My name is John Billings, and I want to tell you the story of a particular covert mission that I did for the OSS in World War II. The name of the mission, of course it was a code name, was called Greenup. I had my logbook here, which I am going to refer to for accuracy. I'd like to mention, though, before I start, whenever we had agents on board, the front crew, that is, pilot, co-pilot, navigator, bombardier, and the flight engineer, the radio operator, we would never see the agents. The typical operation was that we would get in the airplane, in our revetment, start up the engines, check out the engines, synchronize with control, and leave, and taxi out to the end of the runway. We would then wait. In due time, a non-lettered or any other identification, a little panel truck would drive up underneath the right-hand wing, just behind the wheel, and the agent or agents would get out, get in the bomb bay, turn aft, and then a person would signal to us that they're on board, and we could close up and leave, and then we'd start our mission. We would then fly to where it was we were going to drop them out, do so, and then come home. This mission was a little different. If, when we got to the target area, we did not get a signal from the ground, or if the weather was too bad to drop people out, then we would just simply turn around and come back to base. Well, this was the same starting. We started out at the base in a place called Brindisi, Italy. We loaded four agents into the back, one of which was their dispatcher for the OSS team, and he was to come back with us. He wasn't going to jump out. The other three were the agents who was going to be face-to-face with the enemy behind the lines. We launched. It was a reasonably long trip. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you exactly how long the trip was. 6 hours even. Partway to the target, the radio operator got a discrete coded message. He translated it, handed it to me. It says, in the event of incompletion at the target area, do not return home. Return to a base called Rossignano. And that is what happened. That was the 20th of February, 1945. A very cold night. We got to the target area, which was a lake that was frozen over, and the surface was 10,000 feet above sea level. That's where the three agents were going to land. Well, we got there, the proper place, navigator said so, right below us, but we were in the clouds. There was no way that I was going to let three men jump out not seeing the ground visually, even though I had every confidence in my navigator for accuracy. That was too much to ask. So, we went off a little bit, maybe 20 miles, and accurately stayed on a straight line, and then turned around and came back on that same line to take another look and it was still no go. So we went to the alternate, Rossignano. That was that day. Now, this was the very first time that the front crew ever met the face of a OSS agent that we would drop. In fact, I'll tell you a little bit about the agents. We, the crew, were not supposed to know nor ask names. Everything was on a need-to-know basis. We didn't need to know their names. And of course, the reason for that was if we got caught, we can't give out their names if we don't know them. Well, next morning, we went to the chow line, and of course, here are the four men. And we introduced ourselves, and that was Joe number one, Joe number two, Joe number three, and Joe number four. All the agents were called Joes, with the exception, on rare occasions, they would be an agent we'd call Josephine. I personally had never seen one, but my back crew said that's what we had that night. We did a lot of talking, and an interesting little tidbit on the story is that my bombardier, his name was Dick Gottlieber. He was first generation German and could speak reasonably good German because that's what they spoke in the house when he was growing up. Well, he and a team leader, now of course I know his name is Fred Mayer, would speak in German because I wouldn't know what they were talking about. But in that discourse, they traded their hometown. That's just a point for later on. We spent the day more or less telling stories, talking, and then for that night we were going to try again. However, the camera-equipped P-38 Lockheed Lightning came back and it was just total clouds. There was no way that we could do anything, so we didn't launch. And then on the 22nd, one of the stories that Fred told us was how much flying that he used to do and how many different kinds of airplanes he flew. So on the 22nd, the second day that we were there, my navigator had asked if there was a possibility that we could go on a short test flight to check out the accuracy of the indicated airspeed gauges. There were two in the cockpit and one in the navigation compartment. So, sure. Well, as it turned out, my co-pilot did not like to fly. I mean, he did not like to fly the airplane. That wasn't his bailiwick. I'll come back to that later. So, on those kind of flights, I would ask the tail gunner, the flight engineer. There was quite a number of people who really liked to fly and appreciated the opportunity. Well, here we have Fred Mayer, who has flown all these different kinds of airplanes. So I asked Fred if he'd like to fly the airplane a little bit. So he said, oh yeah. So we took off and we did our calibration run. And then I turned the airplane over to Fred. Of course, he knew very well that most OSS missions were very low, sometimes treetops, sometimes between the trees. And he flew the airplane across Rosignano Bay, the harbor there, at the little sailboat mast height, and flew right toward a cut in the mountain on the shore, and did a beautiful inwoman. I thought, boy, he is a good aviator. Then later on, several weeks later, I was called into my colonel's office at attention to explain why I flew the B-24 at shingle level over the Rosignano headquarters. At that point, Fred was safely inside of Germany doing his thing. Anyway, that was that day, and then on the 23rd, the P-38 came back and said there's large breaks in the overcast over the Alps. So we launched, went up there, and that took 6 hours and 15 minutes, and still no results. We went back and forth on this single line. I say single line so that the people who might see us on radar could not pinpoint where we were interested in. But we finally gave up and came back to base. And then, on the 24th, we stood down again, and the 25th, they said, okay, it's good enough. That was an interesting night. We get up there, and again, absolutely no visibility. Could not see for absolute certain where the drop zone was. We could infer where it was because of the rim of the, if you would imagine, a soup bowl that we had to deliver them on the bottom. The rim probably was in the neighborhood of 13,000 feet above sea level, whereas the drop zone was 10,000 feet. So that was covered over. In the meanwhile, the day before, the dispatcher, the team leader, Fred, and my navigator and bombardier pored over the maps, and they found a suitable site for them that was a little further away. It would have taken them another day to get into Innsbruck, but it would save the mission. It was lower. It was over the one of the rims, and so we decided that we'd go look at that. And it was relatively close to the near side of the rim. So I cleared the rim and then took the power off all four engines and started down. And all of a sudden I realized we are going down too fast. What had been known, and we were told before we left, but forgot, at least I did, that the wind speed at the top of the Alps that night was going to be over 200 miles an hour. Well, when the wind crested the rim and started down, the wind direction went from lateral to down. And whenever that happens in the Alps, they have a name for that wind. They call it the phone wind. Because not only is the speed handled by the velocity, but because when it starts down fast, each 1,000 feet or each foot that it goes down, the air itself gets heavier and therefore accelerates. My navigator, who recorded every little thing during a trip, recorded the time that I closed the throttles and the time that we got to the bottom of the valley was 18 seconds. And it was 6,000 feet difference in elevation. When I realized that we're in a situation, I had put the power up to maximum continuous power on a B-24. That meant that each of the four engines were putting out 1,000 horsepower. Obviously wasn't enough. So I put it up to a setting called MITO, maximum except takeoff. And that was the maximum amount of power that you could use continuously, theoretically. It wasn't enough. So I put up takeoff power, which is 1,200 per engine, 4,800 across. That was not enough. So I went on to what was called war emergency power that we could use for 5 minutes under an emergency condition. Well, I decided this was an emergency condition. So I put it up there. That was 1,450. That's actually 250 horsepower more than maximum takeoff power that the design in Pratt & Whitney said the engine could withstand. That wasn't enough. And we're still going down. So I turned it to maximum. The turbo controller, I just hit the stops. And the only limitation to that was that it would not overspeed the turbine, because that would be catastrophic. If you overspeed a turbo, then it could fly apart. That seemed to slow us down. However, when I look back on the situation, it really was the fact that we were getting to the bottom of the valley, so the wind couldn't blow down anymore. It started to blow horizontally, which was probably more than just the power. So now we got to get out of there. We could have turned southward and flown down the valley into the Brenner Pass and eventually just go right down to sea level in the Adriatic Sea. However, the Brenner Pass was the most dense anti-aircraft portion of the whole area in Nazi Germany, and its captured grounds. So that was not an option. So all I did was fly back and forth across the valley, which was only seconds at the bottom because it was so narrow, gaining a little by little by little. And we finally got up to the top of the mountain, back over 13,000 feet, 22 minutes later. All that time, those engines were putting out that unheard of power. For us, the fortunate part of that was it was in the Alps. It was in the winter. We're talking about February. And it was very cold. Later on, my co-pilot, who was independently handling all the cooling and power settings and all that, said that not one instrument went out of the green. And that probably, just because it was so darn cold, was probably in the neighborhood of 50 to 60 degrees below zero at those altitudes. Well, we got up there, got out of that downdraft, and returned to normal power. We double-checked everything and decided that, well, we better go home. But first, we'll go back over the primary target. And lo and behold, it was wide open. Great big hole there. So we made a run and let the three men out. And then we went on our straight line again. And in due time, we came back. And they flashed us the code, meaning all was well. So we gave them the rest of the equipment that they were bringing with them. And then they went about their business. We were finished with the mission. We turned around and went back to Brindisi. It was a little over 19 hours and 3 flying days and 20 to 25, because we got back on the 26th, the morning of the 26th, but 5 full days away from our base. We didn't get any further information until after VE Day. And then it was just a curt little thing saying that Eisenhower decided that particular mission, what Fred and his team did on the ground, was the most successful mission in World War II in Europe. I'm proud that I had a little part in it. The powers to be thought enough of what I did to give me the Distinguished Flying Cross for that mission. I thought I was just doing my job, but I still have it on the wall over there.